All right, welcome. It's the Water Commissioners meeting for January 31st. Calling meeting order at 6:02 p.m. And the first order of business, 6:05, 6:15, is Citizens Query.
Yes, I have a question. Tim Toomey, 355 Central Street, Raleigh. Several months ago, I came in looking for the free cash for last year. The figure, what was that final figure? You were going to look at that?
I don't believe it's been set yet, has it?
No.
No, it has to be certified, as you should know, by the state. We haven't seen it yet.
So there must be a proposed figure going in to the state at this point.
We never see it until it's certified.
Oh, we used to see it years ago. There's no figure that...
It's Citizens Query. We'll take the questions in and we'll look into it. I don't have it. I don't have the answer.
Yeah.
I will say that.
Okay. So with the free cash as a figure, that's something that's over the budget, or that's the budget money hasn't been spent. So the free cash is a figure, it's like a surplus of money. Is that going to be equated into the rates this coming year?
Again, I'll take that, this is Citizens Query. We'll take that question and we'll get an answer to it. So.
The second question I had was that is the only advertisement for this meeting on the town hall board and also on the front door here?
Sorry, I was making a note on someone's phone rang. Say that again, Tim?
When you advertise this meeting,
yep.
It's always on the front, outside the door of the clerk's office and also on the front door here.
Mm-hmm.
Is it also going to be on the internet site so we can figure out when the meetings are?
It is.
Last several meetings, I missed them because I didn't see them on the internet.
We had, again, we'll take that question and we'll get to it, but I do know that we had some turnover and the person that was doing the web work left. And so just recently, someone, Mary Beth, has web capability and she's going to start doing that again. So we had a deficiency.
All right. So the last, several meetings that was a problem.
Well, it's the place we have to post it is at the clerk's office. Beyond that is over and above.
Correct.
So.
And then the last question is, why isn't this this meeting televised live? I've been trying to see it on TV. It takes a few days before you can see me take.
That is a question I would direct towards the selectmen. We don't have any control
over. We don't
have
the capabilities of doing it.
I'm not going to discuss it. It's not our call.
We don't have fiber optics, and mm-hmm. so that is boo-goo bucks to wire up this room for capability.
Yeah.
Well, why was it televised live before?
It was never televised live.
Not to my knowledge. No.
No.
I mean, I'll ask the selectman, but I think Mary Beth.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you. Citizens Query, anybody else have any questions? There being no more questions from the floor, we'll close Citizens Query at
Can we just make sure we add those three questions to the agenda for the next meeting so that we
You got it.
So we will close Citizens Query at 6:06 p.m. and move on to an appointment. And you guys are here early, that's great. Excuse me. Beth Demento, 497 Main Street, to discuss concerns on the water pressure. So,
Aunt Bill Demento.
I'm sorry. I was reading.
I know.
I've
been emailing back and forth with Mary Beth. It's been very helpful about the issue. Just a little backstory. We've lived in our house, 497 Main Street, since 1987. We have approximately 1,700 plus feet of service line from the water main to our home. When we first moved into our home in 1987, we had a problem where the water main erupted in our cellar and flooded the cellar because of water pressure, high water pressure. We hired someone to come and put a pressure regulator on it. We have a gauge before and after the pressure reducer, PRV or whatever it's called. we monitor it on a regular basis. Because our service line is so long, we're very concerned with breaks in the service line and wasting water and the cost of water. And Bill frequently checks the meter pit and, you know, to make sure we don't have a leak along that 1,700 feet. In the last year, we've noticed in our cellar that our pressure gauge before the regulator has been extremely high. I take pictures of it on a regular basis. It ranges from 125 to 160 psi. And then we decrease it within our pressure with our pressure reducing valve down to about 45, 50, somewhere in there. It hadn't always been 140, 150, 160 psi coming into our house, but in the last year maybe or so, it's been that high. So it's a concern to us because, number one, that's extremely high. That's way higher than average municipally supplied water pressure. And we're concerned about a 30-year-old service line that we have. We're concerned about aging water mains in the town. We're concerned about leaks in the town. And having that much water pressure is abnormal. So I came and spoke with Mary Beth, and she was surprised that our gauge was reading that. We've had our gauges calibrated, so we know that they're accurate. So she sent Rob Swiniarski out to test the pressure along, I believe he did the hydrants before and after our home. He came into our home and read our gauges and everything. And he was surprised. They were under the impression that the water pressure was somewhere between 100 and 110 psi, which apparently is typical for the town. I think his readings were at the time 120, 130, 140, somewhere in there, which is what they consistently are. He told me at the time that he was going to come back and look into possibly putting a pressure reducing valve in the main, because that pressure is not good for the main, nor is it good for our service line. And I understand, I'm aware of the bylaws. I know that the town does not make any promises to water pressure. I believe it's implied in that low water pressure, but it doesn't specifically state that. I don't think most people complain about water pressure that's too high.
I've had to replace something on my water heater because I was getting 110 coming in the house.
Right.
I didn't even, this is before I was on the water board. I thought the water heater blew, because
right.
I've gone through several water heaters as
well. That was at 110.
It was at 110, 115, and explains why I could cut off my whole yard with my hose. But the device they put in brought it down to like 50 or 60.
Yeah, that's,
right.
I mean, so, by code, when they built your house, they should have put that in.
Right. We didn't know the first week we lived in our house, but we found out very quickly when we flooded our cellar and all of our hardwood floor material and doors and everything that were in there at the time were ruined. We understand we're protecting our water heater and our piping in our house and everything by reducing the pressure in our house. But we would like to protect our 1,700 feet of service line by reducing the pressure in the town's water main. It can't possibly be good for your water main and your, you know, seals and hydrants and everything else to have that much pressure.
So we've gotten your note and your correspondent, and this is the first chance we've had a chance to talk with Mary. We don't talk outside of here like we're not supposed to, so you have to bear with us.
Okay.
We've got to have a conversation.
And I don't know how much you guys know, so that's why I gave you all that backstory.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if you have anything to add to what I've said.
You got to say something, Bill. You're here.
Yeah.
I'm usually the one that says something. So.
Everything I know.
She's doing a great job.
I've learned from
her. She's doing a great job.
She's the one that, rightfully so, questioned, is that good? And I said, no, it's not. Yeah. One thing I'll say is the water pressure has not increased since they put the new tank in.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the same pressure when I work for here as it is now. It hasn't changed.
Well,
I've noticed an increase, though.
The only way it can change is to put a higher tank in.
Well,
it's all gravity.
Or we've cleaned lines. Anyways, I'd like to hear from the pro. first.
I wouldn't necessarily copy.
Well,
but
you're managing
anyway,
the system.
In your packet, you have a copy of the email correspondence that I had with Mrs. Demento, which you know, I'm obligated to follow the rules that the board sets for the department to follow, and so and I have to stick by them, and the board is the only one who can make the decisions above this. And Mrs. Demento understood that, and so that's why they're here today. So when I did send Ron out, just so that you can hear that what we did is we checked the upstream fire hydrant located at 431 Main Street, hydrant number 32, and the PSI was pressure was 120. Downstream, the fire hydrant pressure located around 494 Main Street, hydrant number 33, the recorded pressure was 125. The pressure gauge located in the basement basement of the house before the pressure reducing valve was recorded at 140. The pressure gauge located in the basement of the house after the reducing valve was 55 psi. So they are their internal plumbing is protected by the valve. I know Rob had mentioned about putting in a valve in the water main, but we can't install anything on the private service. Later on in the program, under new business, there is a project for the board to consider which would evaluate system pressure and PRV investigation system-wide. There has been issues brought before the board in various parts of town. Unfortunately, where this property is located at the sea level from the tank, it's, and you know, where we operate the tank, if you do have fluctuations, it's because, and it won't be drastic, but when I first came on board, they were operating the tank not at full capacity, which meant you didn't have a million gallons in storage to fight fires. So we, with the treatment plant coming online and trying to set the set points for the treatment plant to come on and off, based upon the tank levels, because the tank can be filled up to 36 feet of water. It wasn't even close to that. So the if we drop the level in the tank, then you're not going to have your full storage. We've actually increased it 2 or 3 feet since I've come on board 2.5 years ago. To get that extra storage for fire protection.
Talking 1 or 2 pounds.
I know. But
that's the answer to the question, because I've noticed this over the past year. I started to notice that the pressure was creeping up, because we normally would run around 120 psi on the meter that we have.
How old is your gauge?
And
is it the original one?
I'm not going to say that it's totally accurate. All I'm saying is it's relative.
I'm just curious as if the gauge is starting to fail. That's why it's reading higher.
No, because
you double check it.
No, it's
no. Our numbers. No, they're right.
The numbers
probably
right.
We were
just
out
curious.
Our gauge is failing.
Our house is not at sea level.
Yeah. Our house closer to sea. You're closer to sea.
Yes.
Our gauges. We do. Our gauges are. So that's why. Mm-hmm. I ask the same questions because those are standard questions that do get asked. Because
that's why he came to check it.
And just
the question.
It wasn't that, you know, it wasn't believing. It's just that sometimes if you're right, if you don't use something, a piece of equipment, it's not calibrated, you know, it can skew.
Well,
but this is not the case here.
Yeah, I gotta say, with the CalSequest and everything else that's been put in the system over the years, there's a good chance it could have been.
But
your
readings were.
They matched what the plumber had told you.
And I talked with Beth about all that, so I understand where you're coming from. What I've noticed over a period of time, and I can't be exact of what period of time it is, it's a year or more, that we've gone from 120 psi to around 140, and at times even higher on the incoming side. And that's what concerned me, because now I'm at 75% of the pressure capacity of the line. The line's rated for 200 psi. It's a service line. It's a we have a 1-inch polyethylene Hastings service line.
What size?
It's 1-inch.
1-inch.
Yeah.
I'm surprised you got that much with all that long distance at a 1-inch line with the friction loss.
Yeah. Well, standard service is 3/4, because I was running it so far. I upped it to 1-inch.
Yeah. We don't even use 3/4 anymore.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Where is just being nosy? But where is 497 Main Street?
Just north of the railroad tracks.
You go over the bridge.
Yeah,
it's a shot right that kind of goes backwards again.
It's kind of way off the street.
Yeah, 2nd road after the bridge.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it was a bunch of, okay, so that's...
But the bottom line is, my only concern was that I noticed that we've increased about 20 PSI, so now we're really starting to push the capacity of the line. It's a 1,700-foot line, and we do have a pressure reducer at the house, but not one out at the meter pit.
I just said, could you put one at the meter pit?
Well, I guess, does the town really need to run 140-plus PSI in their lines?
Is well, that what happens is you have the height, like Seaview and stuff, where it runs about 55 to 60 up there. Mm-hmm. So to get your fire protection up there, they used to have to have an auxiliary pump to pump it up the hill, mm-hmm. and there was a system set up with two hydrants that has since been eliminated, mm-hmm. that if there was a fire up that way, we had to set a pump at the bottom of the hill and pump into the water main, which isn't good, going from 100 to
80. No, I don't understand, and I just, and Mary Beth, I'd look to you, or maybe if you know, no offense, Rennie, but if it's 120 and 125 on either side, and they're getting 140 coming in from the meter pit, what would cause,
well,
and the only thing I can think
it's
of
all, is it also has to do with sea level and gravity. Yeah.
From a physics standpoint, if you reduce, and the only reason I bring this up, if you reduce the size of a line, you're going to increase the pressure, and my thoughts are, I don't know if it's rocky down there.
You increase the volume with the size of the line, not the pressure, right?
But you'd increase the pressure. If you were reducing
just the volume.
It's the volume.
If you squish that line down, you increase the pressure.
Coming out, yes.
PV coming.
It's the it's Bernoulli's principle. If you,
has it all to do with friction loss?
Right, but it's Bernoulli's principle.
What happens
the volume, the
every 10 feet mm-hmm. of height, that's either you're going below ground or whatever, you're talking 5 pounds of pressure.
Mm-hmm. But my concern is that they've been stable for years, mm-hmm. and now all of a sudden they're not. So.
Well,
theologically,
I'm
just saying.
Beth explained the difference in why we've seen an increase in it, and it's only relative. You know, for
just talking 2 or 3 pounds tops.
I mean, I was just that's
guess,
the only
I
thing
I guess
we've
I
done.
Question yeah. what's best practice. That was my biggest question on this: is what's best practice mm-hmm. for a municipal water supply to be supplying homes? We all know that we had to reduce it at the house. We learned our lesson that we needed to do that when we
built
the house.
And that's actually plumbing code. That probably when your house is built, the code, I don't know what was in place for a plumbing code, but I know when I built my house, that was a requirement.
Yeah. In 87, I don't think it was a requirement.
Yeah.
We
and
just
it's required, I believe it's around 55 to 60 pounds maximum
in the
house.
To the inverse swimming pool that we...
After the new tank was installed, the town has had more than sufficient pressure. But
mm-hmm.
I guess my question now is what's best practice and what should we expect? Should I have to expect to put another pressure regulator out at the meter pit to preserve my line? I'm just concerned that it's creeped up pretty substantially, and I'm at about three quarters of the bursting strength of the pressure strength.
But if it's you're saying it's creeped up at your house, from what I'm reading at the hydrants, it hasn't changed any since I worked there. So you're talking 30 years, it hasn't changed.
So are there neighbors?
Marianne, Mary Beth just said that we increased the height of the tank over the past 3 years. And
yeah,
that was 2 or 3 feet,
you're talking half a pound a foot.
I mention that because that's the only thing
yeah.
that
the
I'm aware
change.
Of
so,
of a
I mean,
change
that, that's
hydraulically.
Insignificant. You wouldn't even
it
see
is.
It.
So do you have nearby neighbors who are basically working off the same stretch of main?
There's not too many neighbors in our area.
Do any of the neighbors have similar issues as
we
far
don't,
as you know?
We don't have neighbors enough to talk to. We can't see it. Can I
get some space?
My closest neighbor's half a mile away. There aren't that many users beyond the railroad bridge down there, and the users that are down there are close to the main, so they probably don't have the same concern that we have of the length of the line. So my biggest question is, what's best practice in municipal water supply for pressure? And if the town is going to look into the pressure through a study, I think that's a good thing, because it might be in our best interest, as Beth mentioned, to take a look at the pressure regulation. Maybe different parts of the town need different pressure regulation. I understand the Seaview mm-hmm. thing, but you know that's the exception, not the rule. If we're mm-hmm. making exception for one place,
well, there's other high points
to,
in town too.
Well,
you're talking Forest Ridge with all your commercials they're trying to build up there.
Is 120 to 140 pounds of pressure delivered as a household service? Is that best practice?
It's a lot of towns do that. Have that? Yeah. I know Georgetown's pretty close. They're pretty close to me, and even with Georgetown.
Yeah, their system, because we've got an interconnection with Georgetown.
Depending where the tank is, we can give water or take water, depending on, they give us water if we're low or, you know, but if we're both up, we're pretty even.
Mm-hmm.
So
they're not as close to sea level as we are, so we may have some spots like your house. Mm-hmm.
So this is not a quick fix, something that can be done in a year. This is a huge capital expenditure for this department. One pressure reducing valve station could cost between $300,000 to $500,000. So that is why I hope the board will consider signing the contract with Tater and Howard to move forward, because we have to be careful. What we do on one part of town could affect what happens over at Seaview, and you could be right back where you are again, where we've installed this unit and we've dropped the pressure dramatically.
That's my concern.
So the system-wide study.
It's going to affect your fire flows for your insurance rates and everything,
right,
depending on what you do.
So the system-wide study.
We're going to get, that's an item that we're going to look at. And so, but for right now, I think we hear you. We need to look into it. We've got another agenda item, but to protect yourself right now, I would
put a pressure reducer in my, and then you wouldn't have to worry
in the meter pit.
Yeah.
Is that something that we can help with?
I'm not.
Or is it on the other side? This is ignorance for me. I don't know.
Yeah.
Because they didn't do it, but here's the meter pit. Here's the pipe coming in from us and the pipe going out to them. Do we put it on the front side of it or the back side?
We wouldn't put it before the water meter. After the check valve, it would have to be outside the meter pit. It would have to be in their service line.
Why couldn't it be in the meter pit?
I don't think there's room in the meter pit to put.
I actually don't know what you have for a meter pit.
I'd have to look.
Yeah, some people have huge meter pits.
No,
some people have small ones.
This is a 3-foot meter pit, I believe.
Yeah.
The staff we have can barely fit to get to the water meter.
Okay.
I don't think I could get in the hole.
But I said, I'm not familiar with his.
We'd have to go back up.
I'm sorry about it,
but we wouldn't be in, and that would be up to the board. We don't do work on private property, so it would be up to the Dementos to hire a plumber to install a pressure reducing valve.
Well, that's what I was just asking, where would it go in this, and if it's on their side or our side?
As long as it's on the opposite side of the
The check valve.
The house side.
It goes in. Your water comes in, goes up to your meter, comes out, check valve.
Half the check valve, yeah.
Okay. There's a valve.
Otherwise, we're doing something in town with town equipment.
Correct. On the other side, you would be.
Well, we own the meter pit, so.
Yeah. Oh. You own from the curb stop, which is a shutoff just prior to the meter pit.
So we're allowed to do whatever it takes to solve our own problem there if we decide not to wait for the board to take action.
It will be a while for us before we can act, frankly.
If you do decide to do anything, you do need to, it's just a technical, make application. If you're going to alter or change that existing setup.
Even though we own it.
Yeah, because our meter is in there. And so if you're going to alter that meter pit, if you're going to put some kind of vault in the front yard, if you're going to exchange it, we need to know what's going on, and we have to update your record. And of course, we would work with you and whatever plumber or contractor you decided to. We would be there supporting whatever until we can come up with, the board can come up with a more permanent decision. And more solely, that this type of adventure, it's not a quick fix. And if we had to put in a station, we would have to raise the rates. And I know the board does not want to do that. We're doing everything we can not to raise the rates, but this one project would you'd have to raise the rates to cover the cost. So we allow us time to do the study, to do the right thing. Best practice, you said this would be best practice to get a study going and do what's right, and then systematically putting these things in throughout the town to address some of the areas.
Well, we've tried to do the right thing all along.
This
board is assembled with regards to the treatment plant in here and the HVAC, and you look at the capital projects, coating the tank to make sure said tank is built while rebuilding the Prospect Hill Road. So, you know, the first step and the right thing is to do the study, and then if
it's kind of a dominoes thing where you do it, it all of a sudden start fall, you know, and this affects this, which affects that, and we could be positive for here and negative for here. And
if it comes back that we need to take action, you know, we'll tell people what's going on, and
we understand, and then that we might be an exception where we're on the far end of the line. So we're just looking to see what might be reasonable.
Yeah, you're on a little hill there, but your line is down at sea level.
So you can raise your house 4 or 5 feet.
Pretty close.
15 feet.
Actually, I wouldn't mind having a better view of Plum Island Center. So
I would definitely take care of the immediate bit first before you wait on us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, I was just concerned because we're at three quarters of the brake strength of that line. Mm-hmm. And it does fluctuate. I can see it now. Once the meter do
well,
this.
If the tank goes down 10 feet, you're talking 5 pounds difference.
I don't know, Mark. So all I know is what I read on the meter. So, mm-hmm. But, you know, I respect where you guys are coming from. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks. I'm sorry we couldn't get better information. Oh, yeah,
sorry.
Did you want to take the paperwork with you in case you decide to go that route? You want to say that again?
Yeah, you might as well.
The paperwork?
Oh, okay. Yeah, that would be great. Thank you, Meredith. Thank you.
Anything we can do to help you.
Good luck.
Thanks.
See you guys later.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Thanks.
She's going out to get paperwork. House town meeting, or selectmen's meeting last night.
It was largely a non-event, although.
Yeah, it was kind of interesting, the project about the roads.
The road is the big thing.
Yeah, they came back with a final report for, you know, that they're doing for the, kind of like we're doing for the water mains, they're doing for the roads. Mm. Which one should be repaired for us, what should be done type of thing.
Well, they give us a copy of that so we can...
Yeah, everybody's going to work together with it.
Okay, great.
It's not going to happen overnight, just like water mains aren't going to change overnight.
But the school committee meeting, the school budget meeting was more interesting.
Has that changed?
I didn't watch it. I guess I need to go watch it when we get home, huh? Broadcasting studio, permanent studio.
I do, yes. I currently reside in the basement, which used to be the water board's office.
Put it in a new fire station.
When they're designing it.
Meeting room for 60 people.
I think it's going to be for 30.
Pardon me?
The meeting room's going to be for 30, I believe. Oh.
Have they had meetings on that building yet?
Yes.
Are they public? Or?
They're actually on TV.
Oh. TV. I watch TV one night a week. yeah. If I'm lucky.
Thanks for your help.
I mean, not the news. Yeah, it's just between the kids and everything else.
Life is busy.
Yeah. Quick calculations on the elevation.
Yeah.
That's what they should have approached with that house.
Your jack of bones.
Yeah. Interesting. On just on my memory of the height of the hill, the height of the tank.
Mm-hmm.
Taking the 15 feet off, because she said 15 feet off above sea level. And just doing the math. Interesting. I just did quick calculations.
Yep.
From my memory on what the height of the hill is and the height of the tank, and it came out to 140 for PSI.
So next item on the agenda is the number one update on contract operations. Do you have anything you want to?
Well, it's been about over a month since we've had discussions.
And we said we're going to push it off because of the budget. That's all.
Right. Well, we all got an email for some further guidelines from that. The last we met, you wanted me to do an RFI.
Mm-hmm.
We did do some cold call and try to get, and you also provided us with some example contracts.
Mm-hmm.
And then I provided to the board a summation of that. Basically, if we decide to go this route, we can continue to reach out as we find new utilities. But what I'm finding is I'm finding prices from $500,000 up to $4 million. So it's very difficult to find a system because everybody's contract operations needs are different.
Mm-hmm.
So the closest one, system size-wise, is Salisbury. But the thing they don't have that we have is that treatment plant. So Salisbury, for example, it's about $586,000 is their annual contract operations. And they have two operators, but they have pump stations and a couple of storage tanks. So,
and they also have a DPW.
Well, they have
for
full,
office staff and stuff.
Right, they have a full DPW, but the water department does not dig. They contract that out.
Penechuk run them?
Penechuk does their contract operations for water. They also do their billing and customer service as well. So they do not have any overhead in their water department for additional buildings, equipment. It's all, they don't have what we have here.
Mm-hmm.
So we can continue to look, and if the board decides, basically we cannot go out unless we have the funding. That's my understanding. You have to, if you read the email from the procurement officer, we need to have the funding to back up what we're investigating.
What's you want to point to? What's worth saying that?
We received a memo. Actually, we received a couple of correspondence. The first one was back in October of 2016. We had reached out to the procurement officer, and she had provided the board and myself with a nice memo of, some of the stuff to comply. And then in an email, because the board had wanted me to continue with pursuing doing an RFQ or an RFI, and then it was in the email correspondence that came after that, that mentioned that you really need to have the capital to go out for these types of things. So that's, if the board wants to take a look at the information.
What they're saying is we can't go out for an RFP if we haven't already put earmarked funds to do said RFP activity, which is kind of an asinine situation. How do you get a price? It's chicken and the egg. So,
like what I'm doing, we have
yeah.
I have a folder. Mm-hmm. We have like some. This one is from like Salisbury. We mm-hmm. have one from, I think it's Chelsea. We have Gloucester.
So if we look at Salisbury, which is about our size, and it's $600,000 to run that part of it.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, our budget annually, I think, is what, $2.8 million.
Right. So what we currently pay for wages and salaries
mm-hmm.
is around the $500,000, mm-hmm. but that does not include post employment benefits, those kinds of things. Any
and it does include a $13 million bond that we have.
Mm-hmm. No, that's part of our that's on the balance sheet. I mean, you'd have to, when you do that, it's just, you know, we'd still be obligated to be taking care of that. So that's just, but this happens all the time out there. So what I might do is contact a few companies that I know that do this and ask them for some guidance, and then I'll get back to you and find out what
they
think.
Thank you. I would appreciate that help. But we can continue to do that. I just wanted to quickly, because it's been a while since we talked about this, and I thought, you know, we should just do a little quick overview just so that we can kind of sort of redirect ourselves here.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So I'll do some research on that. Okay.
Thank you.
Next one, two, update on 2016 water liens.
So you have in your packet the list of the properties that went to lien with the total dollar amount that's owed to the water department. And this will be collected through the treasurer's office. This is on the tax bill. So when the tax bill gets paid, the lien gets paid, and then the monies get appropriated in the right account.
Are there any people on here that should not be on here, i.e. with, you know, invalid individuals in there, or handicapped, or otherwise impaired, or aged people that, you know, we shouldn't be throwing out of their homes? Have we vetted this list?
No.
Okay.
Well, we're not throwing them out of their homes.
Well, I'm exaggerating, but
Did when they go to sell the property, that's when this is taken care of.
Okay. No, I know that.
There's a duplicate halfway down. John Howland shows up.
I don't discuss the names. Just count up or use the parcel ID.
01599.
I want to mark my copy now.
Yeah. Well, the third down, it's duplicate. Well, the date's different, that's all.
I will look into that tomorrow.
What does the amount and then tax? Are those numbers the same? Yeah. So we've got amount, tax, and the balance. Just what does it? How does that? What's that mean? My own understanding, Mary Beth. I'll read the report.
That's all right. Amount, tax, balance. I'm not quite sure, Mr.
Well, there's a recoding of it. I don't know, but my guess is that it changes from our accounts to the town accounts, because now it's going to be a tax lien. Right? Is that correct?
Mm. Interesting. Okay, so, but I thought we had put something in place where we were going to make sure that, I don't know if it was 65 or 70.
And that takes time to access all of the accounts, and that was not completed in time for this.
Okay.
That 65 and older is up, coming up in the next, on the agenda to discuss.
Okay.
It's, you know, you would want the accounts coded.
Yep.
So they've been doing that, but we've got some anomalies that we're looking to for some clarification from the board on.
Okay.
It wasn't done. They've been working on it.
Okay. Any questions on the water liens?
Nope. Is this the total number of water liens?
Yes, this is it. And then at the bottom, that's the total dollars owed.
What is the total dollars? Oh,
14,267.
Thank you.
Jamie, with 33 accounts.
Oh,
And is this semi-annual or quarterly? I can't remember how frequently we do this.
I believe it was annual.
It's an annual?
Yes.
Right.
It's like every December or whatever.
Yeah, we do get ready in September for the end of the year. Right. Any other questions? Okay. Number three, staffing update under old business.
We have hired a laborer. We started a couple weeks ago, Christopher Renzulli, K-9 Commissioner Emery met him today when he had to go to the fire station to get his ID badge. Very quiet young man. He's going to, I think, he's going to do okay. And I want to talk to the board. I'm advertising on the New England Water Works 3 positions we have open. Still, the assistant distribution working foreman, we have the part-time janitor, and then we have the water treatment plant operator 2 position that are still vacant. So I've been advertising on New England Water Works, which is the where you're going to find a lot of the people who are looking for jobs in the water industry. I have since also reached out to the local newspaper to run the ad for the janitor, mm-hmm. but not the operator positions. Because the papers are local, you're not gonna. It's very expensive. You're not gonna reach the masses. But the janitor position, I thought we might have a better luck putting it in the local paper as well.
Mm-hmm.
So that's going to be happening, and that's. I mean, we're trying to. There's
How
no.
About Mass Water Works. Have you advertised them?
Mass Water Works.
Mass Water Works.
I'm not sure if they have a.
I'm not sure. They used to. When they used to send the newsletter out, they used to have ads.
Yeah, they put the job positions ads. On there. I will look into that, Mark.
You have to look at it online now, and I haven't really looked for it, so I don't know. But I know they used to.
All right, well, good job filling one, and keep at it for the other 2.
So as far as I know, there are no, we haven't had any activity, I mean, on those, so.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, old business number 4, update on video security system 401.
I was going to just do the same thing because at some point I know there was some conversations that were taking place that I was not involved in.
Mm-hmm.
You had discussions with town council. I'm looking for some kind of direction and update on that as well.
Yeah, I wanted to print some out. I forgot to print it out. Just busy. So I'll print it out and I'll send it to you and with some commentary, and we'll put it on the agenda for the next meeting. Basically, it's the location of all the cameras. We want to reevaluate, and I want to get everyone's input and say yay or nay. Like inside this building, I don't know if you know from the top of your head, where are the cameras?
The entrance.
Yep.
The first garage.
Yep.
And the second garage.
One camera each.
Because of the dimensions, there's 2 cameras in the corners.
Yep.
In the back, that's it. There's no cameras in the office space. There's no cameras in here. There's no cameras in the bathrooms, the break room.
Yeah. And what about outside? How many?
Outside, you have 2 cameras in the front,
mm-hmm.
1 camera on each side, and 2 cameras in the back.
2 in the back because of the geometry?
The angles, yeah.
Okay. And then what about up at the water treatment?
At the treatment plant, there is 1 in the entrance. One is in the foyer, and you go through the second set of glass doors. There's 1 in the hallway, but that one is angling down at that door at the end of the hallway.
Mm-hmm.
There is no cameras in my office. There is no cameras in the laboratory. There is no camera in the break room, meeting room, Rob's office room. There's no cameras in the bathrooms or the locker rooms. There are cameras in the process room where your PAW filters are.
Mm-hmm.
They are showing on different things. Basically, the cameras are focusing on doors and windows.
Okay. That's pretty much what I thought. I'll go through the list again, though, and just pass that comment back to you, and then we'll get this thing moving. I know that there was some union concerns if we were looking at people space and this, that, and the other thing. And it's
My staff has no issues at all, and they're willing to write a memo on any of the cameras, on any of their current locations. The only thing that they said, that as long as it's not while I'm sitting at my desk, which they're not, currently they're aware of where every camera is. in both buildings. We've kind of sort of prepared that document, kind of sort of waiting for some back on that.
Yep.
But the staff doesn't have any issues, because we've talked about it, you know,
yeah.
gearing up for the day that we're live.
Well, make sure the union's good too. I mean, we got to cross our T's and dot the I's.
Yeah.
I mean, if I exist in film space all the time, but some people may have some concerns, and I want to make sure they have that opportunity.
I believe it still has to go to the union, and it has to be impact bargained.
From my experience as public protecting your assets, I've worked places where video surveillance has gone on in more stringent than what we have here. And there was never any negotiating with the union.
I'd ask for an administrative ruling. I don't know what the technical term is, but...
Well, they got a ruling from Joe Fair.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Well, we did. But, you know... And then I don't know what impact bargaining means, but...
Well, the concern is we have a contract with the union for 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
We can't...
Basically, it's a change in working conditions.
But here's the thing. If we take this system offline for 3 years, in 3 years we'll be putting in a whole brand new system because...
What I just say, what is it that they need in order to allow us to go forward? And if that's and if there is something that's needed, then I'd throw it all out. It would be cost benefit.
Mm-hmm.
End of story. So we'll just see where that goes.
Okay.
And
maybe just a matter of memorandum of agreement that they don't have a problem with it.
Exactly. And if that's good, we'll go forward and do it the right way. If not, then if it gets into a morass of stuff, I'd walk away. One thing, and this reminds me of, and I'd like to put on for the agenda for next meeting, it's similar to security. And this is a personal opinion, and you gentlemen can weigh in when we put this on there, and that is the lighting here of Stylog 17. From a light pollution standpoint, it's a line from a movie. This place is lit up, and I know you like the security, but it, to me, way too much. So I just want to put on the agenda. Mary Beth, I will give you your full voice too, and the other guys in the board.
I think I suggested it before motion detectors. The lights come on when somebody walks.
Even that, let's talk about that, because I've driven by here a few times, and I'm like, now we've got the security gates, which are awesome. Do we need to have, 2,000 watts on either side of the building illuminating it? And I want to be a good neighbor as well. If I was living next to us, I'd be furious. So, and no one's complained yet, but let's be proactive, that's all. And just think about it. I know you're not pleased with that because it's been a lot of effort put into it, but let's just put on the agenda and talk about the next meeting. You guys okay with that?
Yep.
Okay. So it's just the cameras and security remind me to add that. All right. Anything else on the video, Mary Beth?
No, I was hoping you could.
It's on me to get back to you with the list and so on, so I will do that. Number 5, update on the budget. Everyone's agreed to everything, Mary Beth?
On the budget?
That's humor. Yeah.
No.
Sorry. It's just that time of year. Budget. So, where are we at? We voted on it last meeting, correct? And you were waiting on some numbers for the... What the net effect was going to be with the additional dollar amounts?
Let me just catch up to my thing. All right, so there's a couple of things. All right, so there's a couple of things in the budget. So one of the things that I've included was the six-month projection. Last year around this time, I provided the board with revenue check. It's a revenue check to see where we are. You have that in your packet. I included last year's as well as this year's, so you can see where we are with some comments on where we might have some shortfalls, where we might be ahead on some things. So that's in your packet. Jamie, that's for you.
Thank you.
The other thing on this is you have your 11 by 17 spreadsheet with your report from from Penachuk on your sales to date, so you can see, compare your revenues. I included this, actually, I apologize, this agenda item is about right now budget.
So your revenue check from the projected to actual is only off 0.5%. That's excellent from all the chaos of last year with the drought and, you know, reduced usage and asking everybody to conserve. Projected was 1.58. The actual was 1.57, which is like almost a $9,800 difference, which comes out to 0.5%. That's what I was just doing with the calculator. That's pretty good, all things considered. You'll be able to match that this year?
We'll see.
So all silliness aside, with regards to what you're going to project or what you did with the budget, did you factor in the effect of possibly another drought year, or just to balance it out?
No.
Just average?
Yeah.
Okay.
You also have the budget from the town accountant, and then also have, so it looks different. The one that looks like this is the official report from the town accountant. The one that looks like this one, it's a couple of pages, this is from the peach tree. So this is our...
This is more up to date.
This one is, which one is this one? This one actually has, if you look at the date, this one has a date of 12/8. So the one...
the town's is...
The one that's dated 1/31, which I just got today from the town accountant's office, is the one.
So that's as of December, though, correct?
This one?
In arrears?
This one is...
Isn't the town one in arrears by month?
Yes, so the peach tree one, if you look, if you notice at the top, it says dated out to February. Mm-hmm. In order for us to have been able to include the bill warrant that you signed tonight to get that to show, that's what that is. This is ours. This is to date of what we've actually spent.
So this is through January 31st. Just making...
Yes.
Manipulated the date to get it on the date.
If we had put it to today's date, it would not have included what we did today.
Right. Okay.
So one of the things that, basically we're a bottom line budget. We do have specific monies in earmarked for the lines. However, I've really been working with Brigida on this and really scrutinizing each line item. And so we're trying to fix this, and I should have, fingers crossed, for next meeting. It's a matter of Bridget and I having time to sit down to go into the peach tree and move the money into the right line. So I know that it had come up in the past. Like, for example, last year in fiscal 16, if you look at the budget, it said we spent $43,000 in fee in general. Fee in general... I only carry $10,000 in that line. But the fee in general, a lot of things went in there because we didn't have a line that we could put it in. Meaning it didn't fit in water main repair. It didn't fit in the fire hydrant line. So we're looking at that fee in general, which we went over in the budget, and I'm trying to break that out. So what was in there? Well, it was $4,000 in postage. So we now will have a postage line. Printing and binding. There was a lot of photo stuff like we take to Staples, like to get the large plans or posters or advertisement. So I'm further working to define the budget so that the board and boards to come can see what you're actually. Fee in general should never be like that. I again budgeted for $10,000 in fee in general, and we are being more diligent in making sure that the stuff gets in the right account line. So, down the road we'll be talking about the peach tree, but that's going to help us. So I have an update on that too down the road as far as the budget. But these are the numbers. If you have any question, we're in great shape. If you look at the percent remaining on the budget, overall, I apologize, I cannot read this font so out loud. I don't know if it's my eyes or I need new glasses, but
no, I can tell you, just looking at it real quick and doing a check on percent remaining versus getting into a lot of details, revenue, that looks good. There's, what, 4 months left? 5 months left? Six, 4 months of February. That's good. The salaries, you get 40%. The whole wages and salary line is 41% remaining. So that looks like it's about right on track. The other subtotals, if you just go to the subtotals, it doesn't look like we're deficient anywhere except under the maintenance line. It looks like we've spent more than we had planned to by 7%. But we also have, you know, a bunch of time left.
So can you just put an item on next week's meeting, just any comments on the budget? Because I need to go through this. It's kind of fruitless just to jump around on the numbers. I need to scrub through it.
Yeah, that's fine. I mean, no, this was just an update to us that
we're
working on refining the peach tree, and that's why I was kind of went to the bottom line in the categories, and then it's tracking the right way, I guess that's my point.
Yeah. Commissioner Cullen, we're scheduled to meet next week. Did you want to perhaps have a little more time and meet at the end of the month on the 28th agenda?
No, we can meet on the February 28th. I just want to... times are passing in terms of if this raises any implications for the budget, next year's budget. So I just want to look through these numbers.
Okay.
And I'll be ready for next.
Okay.
Next.
I just wanted to make sure you knew that you had a week, a deadline.
No,
February
7th. Yep. Do we forward? Yeah, it doesn't matter.
We changed our schedule so we wouldn't meet on the third week, so you have other commitments.
Yep, okay. I remember.
Okay.
So, anyways, anything else on the budget, folks? All right, thank you, Randall. Number six.
What about the FY18 budget? Is there any comments to come back to me on that?
No, that was fine. We're just waiting for the update from the what the net effect is when you get the... contracts. Doesn't the town, after they negotiate with the union, tell you what the COLA is going to be and all that?
Oh, so what we're that's all that one's done. What we're waiting on, and it was on the agenda, but it went to commercial and I missed it. What they were discussing the FY18 budget. Did they actually discuss that for the salaries, not compensation? Didn't I see that on compensation for non-union? Did I see that on the agenda?
On this agenda?
No, on the selectmen's agenda. I do remember seeing it.
Yeah.
There was nothing.
So they didn't set the compensation
schedule? I don't
think
it was ready yet.
No.
So that's what I'm saying. Okay. We're not done yet. There's still
right.
Some final numbers that you're going to provide.
They said it was going to be the next week.
Okay, so if they're meeting next week, then I may have something to update for Tuesday. Did you want me to include the FY18 budget on that, or do you want to lump it in with the budget update in general?
Budget update, and then part of it will be the FY18. If you have the numbers, if not, put it to the next meeting.
Okay.
Whenever you get those numbers.
Okay, very good.
So, all right. Residential cross connection control survey update. 27 to date.
I'm seeing on these refusals, there's a lot of places where there isn't water. I don't mind bothering on Stackyard Road, Red Gate Road.
You mean there's no
water down that road, so why are we cross connecting check even spending our time?
Oh, good point. If there's no town water on that road.
Okay, so if the board recalls, we are also working to assist the Board of Health with their updating their records, so and as well as ours. And so what we're doing is we're going to be able, because neither one of our records were 100%. So by checking everything and saying, okay, fine, this person has no town water, then it's strictly private well. So we're working, but actually, I'm very pleased with the progress. We've done 207 surveys, mm-hmm. and only about 132. The community has been great, very cooperative. You know, Joe does and his company does a great job. Mm-hmm. They're very knowledgeable. And then, you know, we've also respected those people that have gotten back to us and said, you know, don't come on my property or I don't want to participate. And so mm-hmm. we've been very respectful of that. But you know, and saying, I don't have town water. So we've not been pursuing.
That's what I was going to say. This,
yeah.
The ones that are saying you refuse, I'm seeing Red Gate Road, you know, Stackyard Road, roads that don't have town water.
Yeah, I had asked him Joe to put a little bit of an overview of some of the ones. So those are the only ones really that we have some comments on, and most of these folks don't have town water anyway. So it's going very well. So I just wanted to update the board on that quickly.
And what's the total number we're going to be doing? 300 and something?
330 or 339.
Two-thirds done. That's pretty good.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
It's moving right along.
In the short period of time that we've been doing this, that's a lot. So I'm very pleased.
And the ones that have active violations.
It says total facilities are 207.
That's the ones that have been done.
That they've done.
Okay. So. Now I'm looking at Leslie Road. There's a whole bunch of them that are past where the water line ends,
yeah.
which is around 115, if I remember right. Yeah.
So look at the last page, and there's some people in Wethersfield Street that have got active violations. Are we going to pursue those later, or what's the game plan with that?
We are going to pursue them.
Wait until we're done, or are we just going to do them on a rolling basis?
We have done some, mm-hmm. but we have not... some of these we have not addressed yet.
Okay. Again, manpower issue.
Well,
else,
that's basically it.
No, I know. That's a lot. All right. Any questions on that? Moving along well, which is good. Vote to have the chairman sign the revised job descriptions. Bernie, checking with you. Have you been meeting on the personnel board on this stuff?
We've got to sign these to have the next meeting. I haven't got an agenda for tomorrow's personnel board meeting. So
there is a meeting tomorrow? If there's a
I
meeting?
I believe there is.
Okay, now I have to tell you if I had received an email from, we've been having problems with our email, and if an email had gotten sent for an agenda, I didn't get it. So, I'm not sure if we're on the agenda this time, Vern. Maybe we're not. I can actually give Town Hall a call tomorrow morning and see if we are.
Well, the meeting would have been today, right?
So it was today?
Would have been today.
Okay. And I didn't get any calls from anybody. Where are you? So I'm not sure if we were on the agenda.
Okay. So what I've done is gone group by group. So I don't remember all the ones we've done, but a lot of them, I think the last cluster that we did was this, the operators.
Yeah, it's those two.
So there's operators 2, 3, 4, and so we standardized them. We standardized them all, making and talking things over with Mary Beth and try to make sure that the differences between them were clear, but trying to clean them up, basically.
Okay.
You've
been through these?
Yes, those are, okay. Unless Mary Beth has made
no,
some
that's the version that Bernie and I have been meeting.
Okay.
And going over the changes, and it looks great. Mr. Cullen, did you do my job description?
Not yet.
Okay. So that's the last one then, correct?
I think there's the janitor.
You still the janitor and superintendent?
Right. I'll have to go through the list. I think there's you and...
So, are you happy with these?
of the ones that are there.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, yes, in the sense.
That's his handiwork.
Okay.
I changed my mind about writing the Great American Novel, I can tell you that.
I'll make a motion we approve of. The commission have the chairman sign it.
Let's second it.
All in favor? Aye. Opposed? As I am signing one.
I noticed that.
Yeah.
But I, you know, I will say that they have Larry White as their editor, and he picks up typos and.
He's good.
You need
grammatical issues, so I appreciate it. So you may have to sign the same thing again.
So be it. No problem.
But I also would like to say, it's been great working with Bernie and actually having some support and help from the board working on a project like that, because it would have taken me forever to really go through all of these. So, Bernie, I want to thank you.
It's a pain in the...
Thank you, Bernie.
Yes, thank you, Bernie.
All right. I'm going to move on to the project status update of the Tater and Howard memo. Instead of getting into, is there anything that really needs to be pulled out of this?
No.
Or just all tracking correctly?
The board, this is exactly what you asked for, just a small little blurb of where we're at, not what we did. So this is where we're at, what the next step is.
And the stormwater road, it rings on hold until the spring?
Yes, we're going to talk about that on the superintendent's report.
Okay. What's that?
We'll wait.
Okay. Update on coding accounts 65 and older. Oh, here we are. Discussing about the accounts that are not straightforward. What is it that's not straightforward?
All right, so we have an email in your packet. And for example, we have several apartment buildings. We have different things that are not so clear as to if one person is 65, lives in an apartment building where everybody else is under the age of 50, do we not shut that one meter off because there's one customer there? Because the property manager didn't pay the water bill. So there's some ones in there that are, we really weren't sure what to do with, because they're a duplex shared by one water meter, apartment buildings, multiple aged people living.
I'm erring the side of caution, like what they've written here. If they're not sure, they're not going to do it.
All right, so. I would like the board to vote, please, if you will. We need a vote because...
How do you need it voted?
I think we need to review these, the ones that they have, one at a time, because I see some here.
Well, that one in particular. Mm-hmm. However, I think if you look at the last sentence there, too, we're not going to shut those off. If you look right here, I cannot be shutting off blah, blah, blah. Right there.
Mm-hmm.
We're not. So I mean, it's that address has had a sorted past, I guess is the best way to put it. There's
just
been numerous questions, issues,
and one of them is the elderly housing.
Yeah,
plantation. I mean, that's all state anyways. So.
Mm-hmm.
But
so
just the one thing, just remember that the shutoff is not the same as the lien process. The shutoff.
Mm-hmm.
Monthly shutoff during seasonal is something we do. The lien process is...
The lien process, I believe, should continue.
Mm-hmm.
It is.
We're just talking shutoff.
Now, you
because they still have to pay their bill, and we still have to recoup
correct.
It in some way or another.
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
So even though these accounts are coded as do not shut off, they still have to receive the letter that says their account is delinquent. And the wording might change in the letter, but we still need to notify these people during shutoff season.
I think that's fine.
Okay.
You know, I think that's perfect. You know, it gives people the reminder, if you will, a gentle nudge. But, you know, certainly the few things cited here, we wouldn't shut them off.
Okay, so with those ones that we're not sure on, you're saying err on the side of caution.
Send the notices out,
mm-hmm.
but don't shut them off.
Or at least, if there's a big question, come before the board before it's shut off.
Don't shut. There's no gun to our head to shut someone off. Just bring it, just delay it, and kick it up to the board, and then we'll discuss it. That's all.
Okay, thank you.
Does that work?
Yes.
Okay, good. Decoding. Peachtree software update. You have two sentences to use.
Two sentences?
We finished, or it's working great.
Well, I can't tell you it's working great because we just got the upgrade installed today. So
excellent.
It just happened today. Yes, I'm very excited.
Now that brings you up like several revs. Is this
what yes.
About 30 years?
Yes. Oh, so God. The exciting part is that the PRS group spent a better part of the day today doing the programming, and each one of our workstations has an icon. So the next on it, we're not going to be able to use that yet. Bridgetta will continue to do her thing with the bills. But the the other portion now is Carol Susie will come in and do the programming with me. Mm-hmm. And once we get in there, we'll get our passwords and some startup and training, and no more signing paper copy POs. No more triple copy POs.
That was one of my things when I first started. I didn't like that.
So what we're going to do is the board is not going to be able to come in and sit at the computer and authorize the purchase orders on the computer. So the only way for me to print out or generate a PO was, let's just say I have to purchase some pipe and it comes to $2,800. I'm going to have to approve it in the system. Doesn't mean that's the final, but I will print it out. So for the backup, the board will sign that piece of paper and then it will get attached with the paperwork. If the board decides not to approve that purchase over $2,500, I go into the system, I liquidate, it's like I never did it. So it's not like it's, but that's the only way to be able to print out a purchase order.
Okay.
Unless the board wants to talk about another way of.
What would you think about increasing?
I was thinking of that too.
At least, yeah.
Yeah, so what's the standard around for other, I don't think, but mm-hmm. from a business standpoint, I'd be, I look at the other boards that I've been on and the directors have budgets, they adhere to them.
Mm-hmm.
You live and die with that budget, We do look and approve the sheet. I go through all those expenses when I sign,
mm-hmm.
and I review them at that point. If I see something that's out of whack, and then, someone had a cell phone they were using personally because their cell phone broke, I think I followed up and was like, has that been remediated? I think if you remember.
We've been doing pretty good,
Have you got a way that you could print off a list of purchase orders for the month that we could just review?
Just email a PDF.
That's making it better for you. So
no, so because that all came up, we've been sticking with the plan. I have a PO log
mm-hmm.
that has every single purchase we have ever made from fiscal 1 on July 1, whether it's under whether it's $5, whether it's 10 grand. We have that, and I always made it available to the board, but this board didn't seem like they wanted to review that. If you would like a copy, Mark,
well,
I can get it for you.
What I was thinking,
I think
is
what you're talking
double
about is
double what you just said.
Incremental?
We
okay.
don't. So
and
I was just going
to. And then what I would like to see is anything that amount or greater,
mm-hmm.
just monthly, a PDF.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're using it and it's online, you can just generate a report.
But what I was going to say is that we've actually been doing really well. We haven't really had, if you've noticed, there hasn't been a lot of purchase orders over $2,500.
Mm-hmm.
The board did just sign those large dollar amounts for restocking, but that's not I'm okay with where it is. If you want to increase it to 3,000, it might capture those ones that are 2,600. That'd be your choice. But you don't need to double it to 5. I can't believe I'm saying that, but we don't have a lot. We don't purchase a lot of things, and we're doing okay since the board did up it to 25. And I have no problem with when we have to restock stuff to bring it to a water board meeting for you to sign.
If you're comfortable with it,
yeah.
it is,
You can raise it to three, because there are some of those purchases that fall in between that.
Yeah, as I said, I'm ready to go higher than that if you need to.
Well, I think anything over...
I think she's proven herself. So.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, let's just bump it up to three then.
Three, you know, see where it goes from there. I'll make that motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Nay. Passes. So your authorization limit's up to 3,000. You know, it's a small step, but it should give you the ability to just get everything done. And the outliers, which is what we really want to see, you're going to jump up. The balance, I mean, there's checks and balances in there between, you know, there's checks and balances. You've got Brigida, you've got...
Brigida,
and then, you know, you get Karen Summit, you have Sue Bailey.
Selectmen look at everything?
Yeah, so I mean, there's enough eyes on all this stuff. Any anomalies are going to jump out. Plus the budget, we hold you to the budget, we look at the budget numbers, so... and I have a pretty good comfort level that, you know, I think you've proven it by looking at the way that the department's run financially. So that'll give you the ability to just get it done. And again, outliers, just bring them up. Questions?
No, thank you very much.
Yep. Number 11, water treatment plant flood update final costs. So $1,100. Is that what we're looking at?
No.
100.
9,000.
It's 111. It's kind of dark. On the lower right hand corner.
Oh, sorry, I got the wrong folder. Mm-hmm.
That would be the peach tree.
Yes. One folder behind. Sorry about that. That's like $1,000. That's wrong. Again, I was looking at the bottom, not at the top. All right.
I have to say, I've never seen anything like this with coverage insurance, but they basically covered almost everything. Everything. Good. We had insignificant dollar amounts that was actually out of pocket. Including a few items that went undetected during the initial inspection that were kind of sort of put on, just watch it. One of them was a computer. Mm-hmm. They paid for us to replace the entire system. The other thing was the boiler. Initially, it wasn't detected that water, but then... once they got in there, we just called them in to do our annual inspection, and they called me up and said there's a problem, and so we were watching it, and they paid for the whole thing.
Good.
Yeah, so it was great. So,
Net rally is $9,900. Is the town rally's piece?
Yes, I thought you'd want to know what the
final outcome was. We still have to do the floors, but that was $950 to do the floors over. We have actually already received the final check from the insurance company. But we're just waiting for the cabinetry people to finish. They've got to do some fine-tuning where the new cabinets met the floor. There's kind of sort of a little bit of a gap, so I'm having them come in with some kick plates to fix it. And once that's done, we're going to schedule the floors, and we'll be 100% again.
So there's no other mechanicals that might have been impacted by the water that we haven't really, like the boiler, when you go into doing it?
No, that's it. We're done. They're actually closed. It's actually gonna be. We've got the final payment, so I think they've closed it out. But everything's working fine up there.
Okay. Anything else on that?
No, that was okay. It, John.
Next item: discuss the hydrant rental maintenance fee, and I had to reach out to the selectmen and talk about that. And one of their notes back, they asked us to stay at the current rate. They also asked why we changed it from hydrant maintenance to from hydrant rental. If they want hydrant rental, we'll change it back to hydrant rental. I mean, it's
I didn't semantics. Even notice that it changed.
It's semantics.
So there's a memo. The board had asked me to reach out to find out with the selectmen if they would discuss and could they afford the increase in the cost. And so what you have in your packet is a memo from the chairman, Joe Perry, with an attachment of some history of the hydrant rental and some reasons why they feel that we shouldn't go up on the fee. So when I had talked about this, they're not renting anything. Nobody's renting. It's just what it was called, but it should be called a hydrant maintenance fee, because nobody's renting anything. Yep. It's monies for the maintenance. And I know that there's been some difference of opinion from the selectmen and on what goes into maintaining one fire hydrant. And I know, you know, I've watched the meetings. But if this town was to hire a consulting firm to come in here and evaluate this program, they would evaluate it based upon the information that I provided back in February of 2014, which started the discussions of not happy with what I wrote. But this is the criteria for what is actually valued. It includes mowing, painting, all of these things, a consulting firm, and they would actually place dollar values next to these things. So it's whatever the board wants to keep it at the 53, you know, level fund it in the budget, which I will have already adjusted the budget, or increase it to the 73.
No, we'll leave it level funded.
I'll make a motion to level fund it.
Okay.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Would you like me to send communication over to Town Hall?
Well, I just want to kind of address one of the paragraphs they're talking about, that services provided to the department. Absolutely, the 14 employees have been hired, promoted, etc. Hiring is required, personnel department to do work, and so on and so forth. Quarry checks, computer assessments, offers, job offer letters, etc. Personnel department, personal advisory committee, reviewing job descriptions. Well, we quadrupled the size of the water department when they bought the plant, or built the plant and hired the staff. The expectations are that there is an infrastructure in place to provide those services, and that we don't do a pay-as-you-go within the town. I mean, if that's the case, and, you know, if people want to use a library more, we'll charge more for the library. That paragraph is a little... I understand what they're saying, but that's really, to quote Bill Belichick, doing their job. With respect to the physical maintenance of said hydrants, they degrade. There's a physical aspect to them. They degrade. They require the list that you put there of things that have to be done for them. And with respect to the hydrant rental fee, it's the only issue there is semantics. And we'll call it hydrant maintenance because it's a more accurate description of what's going on. In the past, it was called fees because there was a non-sophisticated approach to the budget. We've improved the budgeting process, and then it's a little more sophisticated, a little more accurate description. So,
right. I mean, I agree 100% with what you're saying. I mean, I would say that the memo that we sent on February the 24th seemed to be missing the one thing that I thought was going to be explicitly included, and that is the cost of replacing one hydrant. And that's a big ticket. And that, in fact, justifies, in my mind, the upping of it from 53.4 to 72, and that number is not visible.
The only problem is the town budget only has so much money.
No,
that money's got to come out of some other town budget to pay for it. As far as I'm concerned, that's the end of the story.
I understand.
I'm not going to cut library or whoever.
I understand
to
that point.
Put in a couple of hydrants.
Going forward, it's clear that the selectmen don't understand. So whatever follow-up communication we should have should be explicit about what the cost of replacing a hydrant is. And the implication of level funding now is that we're not going to replace all the hydrants that we could.
The other thing you got to think of, we're going to do 10. So
Bernie, the other thing you got to think of too is they took the water department and all the funding from it out of the town budget. So that everything that was associated with the town water stuff was supposed to be self-sufficient. What we're doing now is trying to supplement it out of the town budget. to fix hydrants and whatever. That was not the intention when it was originally made into an enterprise fund. As far as I can tell, what I've heard since it was happened. Mm-hmm. The hydrant rental was put in there as a line item to, because in accounting, this is the way it was explained to me back when I was finance committee, and was, and just put in there, it was supposed to be just balancing off what the town services cost back and forth. It was supposed to be a wash. Somewhere along the line, somebody started going up on our end of it.
Well, now that we're operating, you know, as an enterprise fund and as a business, and I say that we've got to run this thing as a business and not at a loss, that is one thing, and we discussed this at the budget meeting, that yes, we would like to have increased it so that we can do more replacements and maintenance, but we can cut it back to 10. Mm-hmm. And again, it's level funded, but it still maintains forward progress for the water department. And again, historically, that's where it was back in the days of the dinosaurs.
Mm-hmm.
Back now.
Yeah, but the problem is the town budget's limited to what they can't go above 2.5, and they have fixed numbers that have to go. And then you have the school department that's coming in with huge increases.
You're talking to taxpayers. We see it.
Yeah,
it's brutal. So,
I can't see cutting out the budgets to replace a couple of hydrants. That's just my opinion.
Well, no, we're not, and I think we're doing 10 a year. We just cut it back so level, and it keeps going. I mean, versus leaving them there to rot in the ground, mm-hmm. we're doing the right thing as fast as we want. No, but still good. And we all agreed last time we could live with that.
Could I make a comment, Bernie? If you had been to the selectmen's meeting a few minutes earlier, you could have perhaps changed the outcome. It was Selectman Peterson who got up and gave a spiel on it. He did not understand that you had a $200,000 drop in revenue due to the water ban, and I don't even think he knew anything about the cost of the new hydrants. So there would have been a different outcome.
Well, but to Mary Beth's guidance, I try to be very circumspect in whatever I say when I attend this lecture.
Yeah, because you have to speak as yourself, not as the board.
So, Mr. Roth, from a long-term standpoint,
yeah.
You know, I think we've made great strides in mm-hmm. town with the departments and the selectmen yeah. about getting the right channels open. And something like this, last year we surprised them. We learned a lesson. This time we reached out to them ahead of time. Next year, you know, we'll do a better job. You know, it's try to do an incremental, and we'll do a better job explaining that to them. You know, we'll get in there a bunch of time for us and say, listen, this is what we're doing. So that's well taken. Appreciate that.
I was stopped from coming in because there was this bevy of policemen, a gaggle of policemen. They were making promotions.
Okay. That's going to say what to do, right?
I thought the meeting was an executive session, so that's why I didn't go in.
He's just being guided by the police, huh?
any other comments or issues? Okay.
So are we doing something? Something needs to be done?
No, we just...
We need to be...
No, we had already voted to just leave it level funded at 10 items.
And then I just was wanting to know, would you like me to send communications over to the town administrator with your decision tonight?
Just saying that, you know, respectfully, we're going to keep it, you know, thank you for your letter back. Explain it. It's just semantics with regards to fee or whatever. It's just a semantics issue, and that we'll level fund it, and we'll discuss it in the future.
Okay.
It's all pretty simple.
Okay, thank you.
Yep, thanks. Do I need to respond to that since they sent the letter to me?
You can have me respond on your behalf.
Sure, just do it, send it to me, I'll approve it.
I'm probably going to do it via email, and I'm probably going to just CC all the board.
No, just send it to me. And then make sure, you know, you and I will go back and forth on it. Then when I approve, then send it to them. And
all right, so you want me to type it all up,
yep.
send it to you for approval. When yep. you send it, say it's okay, then I can set it up.
Yeah, and then copy these guys too.
Okay.
Unless you all want to be part of the...
No, that's fine.
We can't, actually. We can't. All right. New business. I am going to push this off. You going to table this one?
For the next meeting, or?
Yeah.
Okay.
Just not tonight. Are you guys okay with that?
I didn't find one.
We had gotten a note. Did everybody get that letter?
Yes, he did.
Okay. So there was a note from, I think it was the Deb Egan had forwarded to us.
Yeah, I actually have it right here. I since I got back from vacation, I haven't had a chance to even read it.
It just came in.
Mr. Disney.
Yes, but it's a, so do you know who that group is?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, we
they actually called me before.
I have communications with them. I had that.
It's not a government group.
Correct.
It's a
public interest
conservation type.
Who can have a very vocal presence when it comes time for making rules.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been actually aware of this document that the board has. I've known about this for months. I've been, actually, they call us. So we've been.
I said we're referencing it from what I was screening through.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
So anyways, yeah, let's table that to the next meeting.
Okay.
Getting here. Mission statement, new business number 2. Is this critical to do this tonight?
Well, it is and it isn't. And it will reflect new business number 3. I had emailed out our insert for the 2016, the book that the town puts out, the Amtown
report.
Amtown report, yes, thanks. And so, again, I thank Mr. Cullen. He was very proactive on getting back to me back and forth with some comments and changes. So in our insert for the town meeting report, the beginning paragraph is our mission statement. And so Bernie had a lot of edits and things, and I explained to him that, well, geez, you know, it's kind of sort of the mission statement that was voted on by the Board of Water Commissioners. If you're going to make any changes, we need to make the changes to the mission statement. And then from there, the changes can be inserted into those paragraphs for the town report. So I do need to get back to town hall. I am on a deadline to get the insert for the town report. So I kind of sort of need a vote from the board so that I can get that in.
Right.
Otherwise, I won't have something for the town annual report.
And so the second one here is the
these are my edits based upon basically standard American.
Okay, you go.
Changes. This paragraph, this here, and we grade this out. Is that an addition? Because no strike through.
No, it's a movement of the thing color. It makes it some sort of comments as well. Okay. So it breaks out as a different sentence. Maintain what was in the original draft that Mary Beth was going to report, she had this very long sentence. Maintain regulatory compliance, adhere to established budgets. And then I kind of shifted stuff around so that each sentence was dealt with a specific topic. And so that was before I saw the actual mission statement. I was going by what had been presented, which you can see on the original, on this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like all the edits. Nice job.
Third paragraph, where we say we post Raleigh Water Board meeting dates and times on our website. Probably should say that, and at town hall as well.
I would just say that I wouldn't even put that sentence in.
I'd take it right out.
Yeah. That whole paragraph I would strike.
Okay.
If that's okay.
Less is better.
Do we want to say anything about... No, forget it. I'm going to finish that statement. So, Bernie, your revisions are excellent. Thank you. And I would just strike that third paragraph where it says we discuss and finishes with rallywater.com. And that, I'd say you accept your changes as made. This is for the town report, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Motion to accept.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Yep. Mary Beth, do you want this with the strikeout, or you see the third paragraph?
I think if you don't mind, I will, Commissioner Cullen, would you mind?
We're doing
and then sending me that way I don't make any mistakes.
Right. Sure. So the only other thing on the table is just to standardize the way it's represented. So if you say maximum daily production in millions of gallons, and the need is a number, not.
Did you make any changes to the mission statement as a result of the edits in the town report? Because this needs to be a voted thing. This is your mission statement. You voted. This is something that you've been voting on.
So why don't I revise it and we vote next week?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
That's next week.
That's great.
Yeah, it's next week. And so what is the table? Is this statistical data?
Yeah, it's just the production numbers. So it was just that everything needs to be standardized rather than using, if you use millions of gallons, then all you need is a number. Mm-hmm. And then if you use millions of gallons, then it should be millions of gallons.
Yeah, 144 million gallons.
Right.
0.478
right.
million gallons a day is about already.
Yeah, I mean that's
395,000 gallons.
Yeah,
it's got to be consistent.
So
I agree with you.
The changes you made are part of this. Just get that to Mary Beth too.
Thank you very much.
Yep. New business number four: signing the contract documents with Tater and Howard for the investigation of system pressure and PRV situation. No, I don't feel like it. I got you to look up, didn't it?
What?
Sorry.
That's okay.
Just a little levity. It's late. I should have been ready to snap that picture.
Did I have a look?
Oh, yeah. Because you didn't expect that. So
I didn't.
Why don't you walk through this real quick? I think we've discussed this a little bit earlier.
If just so the board knows, that is something that was on the capital to-do list.
Right. And this is just to get the study done, correct?
Yes, so what this will actually do, this will actually be another capital improvement document the board can use to, as we go through, to do improvements in the distribution system, because some of these things you might want to include if there's a main replacement in the area or something going on. So
will they integrate it to the main replacement plan?
No. That was just me saying that I'm all for lumping things together in projects, that if something happened to be in the area and we were going to replace that main in, say, FY20, but the PRV was in FY19, maybe we want to kind of sort of do it as a project, if we could afford it. You know, just to be able to look at those things to lump. You're going to be digging up the road anyway to put in vaults, so.
Right, but if I recall the main replacement plan, capital plan, that in a certain sense they didn't, they were just going by the age of the pipe.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. Well, if the age of the pipe is really which is a vulnerability, the vulnerability is a function of the age of the pipe and how much pressure is being driven through it. So in a certain sense, if they come back with this survey, then there's another I would see it as another criteria that they would overlay on that plan.
They can do whatever we want with that hydraulic model.
No,
they can do whatever you want.
It's just good information to have.
Yes.
You know, it's a clear picture of what's under the ground.
Exactly.
That's the way I describe it. So.
Do you need to make a motion to sign it?
So, I'll entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion to sign the Tabor map.
No, until I get that right.
What have you called
it? You don't.
No, it's still in document.
It just came in hot off the press at 6:15.
Well, it's the first thing I need to see was the monetary figure.
It's in there.
That's why I'm looking for.
Oh, 7,400.
Oh, that was me just making sure I had all the paperwork together. That's why I apologize. The purchase order's not filled out.
I just want to read, because we got stuck with the last one where I thought we should have been reviewing that. And we ended up paying more to review the whole main thing.
Oh, yeah.
That should have been included, as far as I was concerned.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
And I think stuff like that should be included, that the board should be able to review it without having to pay them thousands of dollars to come down here and review it.
And going forward, when we do ask for pricing, I have asked them to include meetings with the board, because not all projects do include them. It's not a given.
Mm-hmm. I mean,
if you want there to be meetings, you have to ask that as part of the scope of work, and typically it's not that type of project for the capital efficiency. Typically, that's not something that the review is done between email and whatnot. So, and I know it's the nature of how you guys have to meet, but if you want my opinion,
there was way too many mistakes in that to not have a meeting.
But I think the meeting was well worth it because look what we accomplished during that meeting.
Yeah, and I think it should have been included, is my whole point. Is that should have been part of the original scope, is that there should have been a meeting with people that actually know the system and correct street names that are wrong, you know?
But
typos.
With all due respect, the board was given a copy of that capital efficiency plan to review and get back to me, which I could have got back to the engineer so that they could have updated the stuff. So, you know, I personally think the meeting was worth it. I walked away with a better understanding.
Oh, I did too. I thought it was very productive.
And, you know, and I don't know about your thoughts on that, Mr. Cullen, but I thought it was worth it in the end.
I think there are two separate issues. I think the meeting was worth it.
Aye. Opposed? Sorry, just slide that in because he seconded it. Next one is the signing amendment for the sanitary survey compliance contract to include permitting required by the Conservation Commission for well number 2 redevelopment and the installation of security fencing, which is $4,500, Tater and Howard.
That was not part of the original scope of work. It wasn't until Tater and Howard began to put the project together and had conversations with the conservation agent, Brent Bieslack, that permitting was going to be required. Again, it's in the wetlands. Thank you, Bernie.
Yeah.
It's funny how all our properties in wetlands.
Well, we could put a moat around this place.
and a fence.
It's about bad as snow. Too much History Channel. So, Mary Beth, I'm looking for a bottom line here. I see 5,000, 17,000, 14,000, 7,000. $4,500. There is numbers all over this thing.
All right. I didn't have a chance to review this either because...
we'll do it next week.
Yep.
I'm not doing it because it is all over the place. There is numbers in here that are just... one week's like a... This one, two... 3, 4, 5 different numbers.
All right.
I just don't understand. And,
sure. And that, while you're going through the rest, can I just quickly look at this in case I can figure out which one it is? Because this has already been turned into the conservation agent.
That's okay, but we're still here.
So
I'm not going to go through it tonight.
So you want to put this on for 2-7? and have them kind of sort of clean that up.
Oh, I want to know what's the bottom line. Like I said, there's five numbers in there. I can't sign something if I don't know what it is.
Okay.
That's all. It's just not clear.
Gee, it's not just me.
No. Discuss memo from Treasurer Karen Summit. I don't know if that picked up. Just kidding, Karen. I'll just read this. It's from Karen Summit. It's a nice memo to the board. It says, to the Board of Water Commissioners from Karen Summit. Dated January 17th, the Prospect Hill Road Improvement Ban, and that's a bond anticipation note, I believe. As of May 4, 2015, town meeting approved $75,000 as the water department's share of the improvements to the Prospect Hill Road. At that time, the board requested to pay the amount of $15,000 a year over 5 years. We paid down the first $15,000 with interest in FY 2016 and rolled the remaining $60,000 ban. According to your FY17 budget, you will pay down another $15,000 in principal and interest this June. If you have the revenue available, you may want to consider paying off the bond sooner. Each time you roll the balance, you incur a fee of $22,500 from the financial advisor and bond counsel. I think it's reasonable to expect the cost of borrowing to increase given the Federal Reserve recent rate hike and continued expectations of additional hikes in the future. Given the small size, it's also not particularly attractive to investors. If the town were to issue another debt that you could bundle the issue with, it would reduce costs. At this time, I cannot predict whether or not that will happen. I want to bring this to your attention as you work to prepare your 2018 budget. Please contact me with any questions. That's a great note. I don't know if we have the ability to respond.
So if you just, the board would vote, I can work with the treasurer to including this, to pay this off.
Because you're only talking $45,000.
Yeah, so.
As long as it's not going to blow the budget.
We can do it out of stabilization.
Oh. Karen Summit rocks.
No, that's I think it's total sense to me.
Yeah, especially that saves us $12,000.
Yeah.
So
it's a third of that. Yeah.
I'm going to make a motion to have Mary Beth negotiate that with Karen and
I second
proposal.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Makes total sense to me.
So, can I ask how we initially agreed to such a...
It was done prior to us being on the board.
It's just a standard. That's what, when we got together with the town and put it together, and with the FinCom and the board, and just put it together. But Karen, being the chap tactic, she has looked at this and saw those bond council fees. Used to work at State Street, used to process those payments. They're quite lucrative. But it's just an overhead.
I understand that. It's just that I would put it into the cost of borrowing right up front so we would know what that is. And that would obviously have said, well, we've already given them $5,000 for basically diddly squat.
You don't get to pick and choose. If you the bond agent gets their piece of the
interest. No, I understand that. But if we paid it out of the... We're now going to pay it out of the stabilization fund. If we paid it out of the stabilization fund 2 years ago, we wouldn't have incurred these kind of excessive costs.
But it's water over the dam, so all we can do is...
My only concern is let's not do that again so that if we end up looking at requests for funds...
I think you'll find that we have been doing... Look on all our capital expenditures, haven't been borrowing.
Okay. I apologize. I mean, I forget the whole history. It's too long ago for me to remember, but there was a reason we went this route because it was such a small dollar amount, and that it was the intention was really never for us to have this 5 or 6 year loan on $75,000.
If I recall, it was just to try and get it done, and then we were going to go back and get it out. So
yeah,
all right. So we're doing
we're coming back and
pretty much
straightening it out.
Yeah, this was part of our share of the cost for the Prospect Hill, and so at some point
this
one
right when I joined,
we weren't spending any of the money, but see the town was spending their money, and then when they were done and we moved to construction, they were going to use ours, and then Karen reached out to me, or in passing, we came up, and she said, you know, you really ought to spend that money. And so I said, I reached out, and then there were no invoices that came in. We're going to talk about that a little bit to catch the board up in the superintendent's report. I've got something in there.
Okay. All right. Let's keep, let's go. I want this over here. Okay. Karen Sloan, so thank you, Karen. Water superintendent operations report.
Okay. Just a couple of quick things. Pat Snow, the highway surveyor, and I had talked almost pretty much when I came on board about trying to work together to marry our programs for his paving and the water main. So Mr. Snow has his draft program, just like he went through that process like we did with our capital. The two programs are almost pretty much in the same, ready to go for the final version to be released. We also will be sharing a copy of our capital plan with Mr. Snow, and we are going to be working together to make this happen. In your packet, and Mr. Snow has asked that we, just for our information, he's asked that we don't really read the streets out loud because he really doesn't want it to come across as being like etched in stone. This is the same as ours. We're going to have a schedule. This is what we should do, but if something comes up before that, he has the ability, like we do, to shift things around.
So, Patrick, Glenn Fittich, 15 years?
So, basically, they are moving forward in FY18 with those streets, as you see in that first section.
Yeah.
We already talked about putting $50,000 in it, but when we get our final plan to take a look at this, I don't know if the board wants to take a look at this, because the condition of like the our mains that are actually there, because once they go in there and do this work, there's a moratorium.
How long?
Five to ten years.
But what if a pipe breaks under there?
Emergency. It's emergency, and then.
So it's a suggestion.
It's
unfortunately, it's a suggestion. I mean, they can't. The moratorium is. Yeah, we're not going to plan a capital.
No, when emergency is an emergency, it doesn't matter. The moratorium doesn't count.
Right.
But I can tell you from my experience, when a town does not work together and marry the programs, the water department ends up being the bad guy because the water main breaks.
Yep.
I had a $28 million paving project complete. 2 days later, the 24-inch transmission main blew on a main road and caused a worse damage than you could imagine. So it does happen. So when we get those numbers in, we're going to take a look. I'll have that for the water board for looking at the 14th of February to have our capital plan available. And at that point, I'm going to pull out of that report the same areas that the town is planning on doing.
See,
and then the board is going to need to have some discussions of what do you want to do on that.
What is just, I don't know if you know, Mary Beth, but what does crack seal mean?
That's the stuff that they put in the cracks.
The black goo they just seal up the rest?
So they're not repaving.
That's a maintenance item. So by doing that, it's going to give that particular road another additional rating and life expectancy.
They're going to be cutting down 2 inches of old hunt top.
Oh, okay.
And then
that
putting 2
sense.
Inches new one.
And then reclamation is meaning they're just going to rip it up and do another one?
Yep.
So that one they grind and this one they just rip up and do?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Just more education for me. Wow.
So that,
and this is all for 2017 you're looking to do this?
18.
Well, they have, the one thing that they have that we don't have is they have Chapter 90 money that they have been applying for every year and tucking away for this program. Mm-hmm. So they have over $2 million to put towards paving. There are no programs for water, There has not been programs, and there would never be a program for water that would allow you to stockpile cash in a state account for a future project. Usually our programs are, you apply for it, you get it, you got to spend it. I don't know if the board, that was one of the things, Mark, I don't know if you saw this, but there are going to be programs coming up which we will be applying for, monies for infrastructure.
I did see that, yes.
Yes, that's, I was so thrilled to see that, so
the
I'll be working
Mass
with...
Mass Water Works now, just recently, right?
Yes.
It was all gone.
A couple weeks ago, EPA announced it, so... we'll be working with, I'll be working with Taylor and Howard, and whatever we can get, I'm going for all of it.
Good.
As much as we can get, because grant money is free money.
I mean, the last time that they, just before I started working here, they had done a lot of main looping, and that was all grant money.
So there hasn't been really any programs in a while, so that's pretty exciting for us.
So Patrick, you have $2 million, I reinstate my Glenfiddich.
No, he doesn't, he had, last night, it's, I think the whole plan is $2 million
over the course of the.
So they're going to get another million from the state from section, whatever it is, Title 90.
Section 90. Good.
Chapter 90 money. So they've got a stockpile of about $1.2 million.
Yeah, the gentleman who was presenting at the selectmen's meeting did a great job explaining, and it's quick and concise, but he did a nice overview of the borrowing and everything in the program. So if you have a spare moment. In your schedule.
Try and watch it.
Yeah.
And I'll fit it in. No, that's well done for Patrick. That's great that they
get
the money. Awesome.
Another program that I'll be rolling out to the board is the directional flushing plan. We should have the draft directional flushing plan ready for the board around the 14th of February.
Will that, is that something we can focus up towards? Oh, the folks over at the corner, their name escapes me. Husband and wife, they come...
Petrellos.
Is that something we can at least start up in their neck of the woods to see if we can give them any
Well,
relief?
The directional flushing, it will be grouped into zones, and so it will be... That area would be done first because you usually start at your source and work out, even if you're doing your zone.
Okay.
So we'll be looking at that. The other thing is that in order for the directional flushing program to work... Your gate valves have to work.
I was just going to say, you're going to find other gate valves you did that don't work properly.
Right. So what I started to do in to get ready for this program was I tried to put a bid spec out last August for gate valve exercising, and there were some problems. And then one of the staff went out on leave. So that's the person I was working with on the bid spec. So... I haven't been able to do anything with it, so I'm kind
of... Do we have a gate exerciser? Do we have a gate exerciser?
We do. Well, again, staff, that's the whole issue. I, which is, I hate to keep saying that, I'm not trying to make an excuse, but you can only do so much.
You do a few a day.
Like today, we almost, and I'll tell you, we almost forgot to check well number two. We had some unexpected... I was down a man today, we're going over reviewing the day schedule, and I said, oh my God, I forgot to check too, and off they went. We had some things come up that were not planned, so we can put it on the schedule, but a lot of times things don't get done just because things come up that we have to address. It's just, I'm kind of sort of have to rob Peter to pay Paul some days, so it's kind of hard, but we're getting there. So on some good news, we approximately have about 25 potential new services, all at varying stages. I don't know how I'm going to handle this when it all comes to fruition, but we have some active, like eight active potential new services prepared for this year. We've been taking in the application fees and reviewing and working with the developers.
How did things go with the development across the street from well number two? I know they withdrew their permit, their application to do
it. It was for the sign, some kind of sign. Oh, as far as water's concerned?
Yeah. They moved on, everything's
okay. Yeah, they're moving along. Their main extension went in. They've got one service done, and they've been calling us, been going to inspections. We have a couple of their meters that still need to go on, but that's...
So everything's smooth.
Yes,
right.
Yeah. We had a little rocky start, but we worked out the bugs, and now we're working out well. One thing I just wanted to make sure the board was aware, with the Prospect Hill access road, you know, we've had some problems right along. When we got those heavy rains, it kind of took out the roadway. The work that was done by T Ford didn't have a chance to stabilize. And we were on top of it. The town was on top of it. Each time something happened and it was brought to somebody's attention, the engineering firm and T Ford was great. They went out. Somebody made an anonymous phone call to the DEP and reported them, which resulted in an enforcement order. So I just wanted the board to be aware. We were not involved. The town administrator and the selectman and the conservation agent were kind of doing this. Mm-hmm. But I just thought you needed to be aware that there was an enforcement order, so this kind of sort of your domain. Mm-hmm. And but.
So Brent's involved though, right?
Oh yeah, no. We've got inspections. Okay. You can read through the package here. What's considered extra precautions taken up. Larger riprap's been put in. Eels, which look like giant speed bumps, are in the road to try to divert the water until we can get back out there in the spring and do the final work. But T Ford, Tater and Howard, the conservation, the town. It's with all the things that everybody was thrown at, I think it was handled very well. And I just wanted the board to be updated on that.
Yeah, I just want to make sure Brent's in it, so good. All right.
One item of business, the board has authorized me to refund up to $50. And so I need the board to vote to authorize me to refund a customer $92.61 for money that they overpaid during a final a closing on a final read.
That makes sense.
How did that happen? I was just curious.
It happens. I don't know. I don't know. It's just it was
involved. Is it overpayment legitimate?
It is.
Then
okay, make a motion.
Second.
All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Good.
So Mary Beth.
Yeah.
Unless you're going to get to it, I didn't see anything on where we are on the withdrawal levels. I saw the numbers we had, the restatement of the numbers we had previously, but I haven't seen any new numbers.
I didn't prepare anything for this meeting. Everything's back to almost not normal, but there are no issues at this point. We've dropped down to doing weekly drawdowns. If you want, I can pull the most recent spreadsheet for next week's meeting if you would like.
If you notice, the drought situation here has gone way down in the last 2 weeks.
Yeah, the state is still not.
It has, but why won't they make that decision so that we can just...
Because they meet once a month.
I know, but...
And they meet the 1st of February.
So perhaps... so they'll be meeting tomorrow. Maybe by next meeting I'll be able to say, hey, mm-hmm. we can lift the ban.
As soon as I see anything coming through Mass Water Works, I'll send it out.
Okay.
Great.
But the weathermen put it on, it dropped like 2 categories in this area.
Good.
I guess we got a lot of rain while I was gone.
7 inches, my rain gauge.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I got
a weather station, a high-tech weather station for Christmas. It's got a wind thing, temperature, moisture, and it's like 7 inches of rain recorded. So.
I'll have to look at mine. I haven't even looked at it for the month.
It's not where the dog can get.
No, my oldest son put it on a board 3 feet above the swing set. It is, you know.
Mine's on a 10-foot pole up above my roof.
Well, this is the kind you can hook up to your computer and download it to be part of the weather underground.
Yeah.
So, no intentions.
I don't have that either. But is it wired or wireless?
Wireless.
That's what mine is.
3-foot range. Really cool.
Worst part is you have to change the battery once a year.
And keep the ants out. No, seriously, mine went on the flutter. I took it apart, and the whole thing was full of ants.
Ooh.
On the board. On the warmth it was, they were going for that.
Oh. Minutes are in order.
I'm sorry, Jimmy, I just had one reminder. Just a reminder that if you guys need anything you need shredded that has customer information, addresses, phone numbers. Even if you brought stuff home, Just bring it into the office, we can shred it for you if you don't have a shredder at home. Okay. Thank you.
So minutes are in order, and for the minutes of January 4th, I was not here, so just you two will...
Make a motion, we accept them?
Now you sound like me.
I'll make a motion to accept the minutes for January 4th.
Second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Passes? Since I wasn't part of it,
that's hard to call for a motion.
All right. And the next ones in discussion are January 10th. I've reviewed them. I have no changes.
Make a motion to accept it. So is Brian Easy.
So on the fourth paragraph down, says Commissioner Collins said Commissioner Emery was being modest in his update. I would add he was being very modest in his update. What's a joke?
Do you really want us to make that change?
No. I'll make a motion to accept the minutes.
Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Motion to adjourn?
Yep.
Make a motion to adjourn.
Seconded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Good. We're adjourned. Good.
Thank you. That was a lot.
Here goes there. I'm going to take this off me.